Hello everyone, we are today here at the Military History Museum of the Bundeswehr in Dresden, and as you can see, we will take a look at the evolution of the Panzerfaust. We look at the early versions like the Faustpatrone 1 up to the Panzerfaust 100.
Let us start with the origin of the Panzerfaust. According to Fleischer, the development originated with a requirement from the Heereswaffenamt, the Army Weapons Agency, from spring 1942. To develop a simple anti-tank weapon for the infantry. This resulted in several different hollow charge weapons that were of limited use, yet served as a foundation for the development of hollow charge hand grenades. Trials very quickly showed that the muscle power of the thrower was often insufficient to throw the hand grenades, which were becoming increasingly heavy due to the required armor penetration, up to 40 meters away. On the other hand, an auxiliary device and the associated cumbersome loading and aiming process should be avoided at all cost. In November 1942, the suggestion was made to use a cartridge to propel the warhead. This cartridge should be directly connected to the warhead and have a jet exhaust on the opposite side to minimize the recoil. Additionally, it should be fired out of the hand or fist of the soldier. As such, the name Faustpatrone, literally fist cartridge, was chosen. Only later the name Panzerfaust was chosen. According to Zaloga, this name was given by Hitler, but I couldn't find any other source that noted this. I know that Hitler renamed the MP44 into Sturmgewehr 44, since I saw the original transcript of the order myself in the German military archives, which we included in our assault platoon book. Of course, Hitler renaming weapons was quite common, but neither Fleischer nor Hahn note Hitler as the name giver in this case, and Zaloga does not list any German archive material that suggests a primary source as the foundation for that claim. As you might know, there were many variants of the Panzerfaust, so here's a brief overview from the early versions to the later ones. First, we have the Faustpatrone, often called Faustpatrone 43, although Rodman calls it the Faustpatrone 42. Zaloga lists the second prototype version of the Faustpatrone 43, which was significantly larger than the first version. As far as we know, both were early prototypes. After various improvements, the first mass-produced Panzerfaust was originally named Faustpatrone 1 Klein, which later would be renamed into Faustpatrone 30 Klein, meaning fist cartridge 30 small, and finally called Panzerfaust 30 Meter Klein, whereas the 30 meters indicate the effective range. The small was to distinguish it from the next model, the Panzerfaust 30 Groß, meaning large. Initially it was called Faustpatrone 2. Be aware that names like Panzerfaust 1 and 2 were used as well. Different names were quite common in the German army. The next version was the Panzerfaust 60, followed by the Panzerfaust 100. And yes, although the range was improved, from the outside they looked pretty much the same. Jens Mehner will later explain how this was achieved. Finally, there was the Panzerfaust 150. The development was finished in spring 1945, yet it never entered into mass production. Only a small number were produced for troop trials. If you want to see one in real life, the MH in Dresden has one in the main exhibition, as you can see here. Additionally, Fleischer and others note the Panzerfaust 250, which only existed on drawing board. Although Fleischer claims it was finished after the war by German engineers in the United States of America. Something I have not seen in any other source, so again I'm not sure if this claim is valid or not. Now, although the Panzerfaust looks rather light, the models generally increased in weight and were far heavier than a first glance might suggest. In terms of armor penetration, the values are mostly the same with the exception of the early version and the Panzerfaust 150. Be aware that depending on the source, the values might be different. Now, before Jens shows us how the Panzerfaust is made ready for combat, we look at how the Panzerfaust was able to penetrate armor. The effect is called Munro or Neumann effect. So how does this effect work? Here you can see the warhead. Such a warhead is generally called a hollow charge or a shaped charge. As you can see, both make sense because the charge is both hollow and shaped. So when the warhead impacts, the impact fuse sets off the booster charge. This then leads to the detonation of the explosive charge, which focuses the explosion and deforms the warhead's conical metal liner into a high-velocity jet. This jet is so fast that it penetrates the armor. Be aware, it does not burn through. A common misconception and an error that I made myself in the past. Since you know the basics, Jens Wehner will now show you how to operate the Panzerfaust.
Now I will explain to you how the Panzerfaust could be used. At first you had to arm the warhead. Afterwards you have to pull out the safety pin. And then you have to pull out the aiming sights with the ranges that could be the Panzerfaust could be shot at. As you can see, this is quite simple, and this is one of the reasons why the Panzerfaust was used so widely, even by the Volkssturm or combatants who were not so trained in using weapons and Panzerfausts. The Panzerfaust should be used by nearly everyone, and that is one of the reasons why the manual how to use the Panzerfaust was written on it. And by the way, all the danger warnings were also applied on the hull of the Panzerfaust. At first, you see here a German description how the arming of the warhead could be made. And at second, you see some danger warnings like starker Feuerstrahl. This means something like a strong fire jet also, which comes out at the end of the tube. And this was really dangerous for persons who were standing behind a Panzerfaust. You need a safety distance from several meters. It depends a little bit how strong the Panzerfaust was that was used. The more range, the more dangerous, the more longer was the danger zone behind a Panzerfaust. This description is written even two times on a Panzerfaust. So this means this was really a danger which couldn't be underestimated. And there's in Germany at least a quite famous war movie, The Bridge, where a young soldier, a Hitlerjunge, is standing in a room and firing a Panzerfaust, and the old man is accidentally standing behind him. And after the Hitlerjunge shots the Panzerfaust, it is shown that the old man has several burnings, is really, really hurt. So this was really dangerous if you stand behind a Panzerfaust. Now we come to the design of the Panzerfaust. At first, there was no Panzerfaust, but the so-called Faustpatrone, literally fist cartridge. And the fist cartridge could really only be fired out of the hand, out of the fist. That's the meaning of the name. That's the reason why it was called like this. But it was not so sufficient, especially in range. So the Hasag, which was the designing factory or firm of the Panzerfaust, designed to make it better. And it turned out that the so-called Faustpatrone 1, so you see the origins of the Panzerfaust and the original Faustpatrone, was designed. And as you see, it looks really like a Panzerfaust, more or less as you know it from the World War II. It had a warhead which was able with an optimal range of 30 meters. That's the reason why this Faustpatrone 1 or Panzerfaust Klein or whatever it was called later got the name Panzerfaust 30, because the optimal range for shooting this was 30 meters. The actual maximum range was longer. And also the barrel was longer. And it also had a higher load of powder, black powder, which was the propellant for the Panzerfaust. But there was one, let's say, major problem with this Panzerfaust, and this was the shape of the warhead, which too often slipped away from tanks, especially from tanks with a sloped armor. And so the warhead and the shape change couldn't really penetrate the enemy tank. And so it was decided to change this to a flat warhead, so that the warhead was better able to hit the enemy tank and to penetrate it and not to slip away. And this was the reason why the Panzerfaust 30 or Faustpatrone 2 or Panzerfaust Groß, as it was called, had already this flat shape of the warhead. Also, it was bigger, it had a bigger barrel, And the range was nearly the same. That's the reason why it was called Panzerfaust 30, Panzerfaust 30. Afterwards, the next problem had to be solved was the range, because range gave safety to the soldier who was shooting with it. Of course, it was less dangerous for the soldier if he could shoot the Panzerfaust at an enemy tank on higher ranges. So the range had to be increased, and to solve this, the propellant was getting more. It was just more black powder into the barrel to propel the warhead, and the range could be increased. But the problem that was connected to this was the energy during the explosion of the black powder. And so the barrel had to be thickened. The barrel was thicker, needed more material, and was also more heavy, but the range at the optimum was 60 meters, and it also could fly higher, more than 60 meters. And that's the reason why this Panzerfaust was called 60 meters. And I think this is the variant most people know, when it comes to the shape. This is the classical Panzerfaust as it was mostly used during the end of World War II.
As you might have noticed, the Panzerfaust 60 and 100 look extremely similar from the outside. Yet since they have a different range, there must have been a change. Jens will explain how the range was increased without a major design change.
Okay, here in my hand I have a Panzerfaust 60 meters. And as you can see, there is a dummy for the black powder, which was the propellant of the warhead. The question for the German Panzerfaust developer, the HASAG in Leipzig, the HASAG factory, was how to increase range further, because the more the black powder you give in, the more the stresses the barrel, the more the barrel needs to be thicker. And this was not really an option because a thicker barrel needed more material and was also heavier to wear for the soldier. Now, how did they solve this? Because if you look at the Panzerfaust 100, you see that the Panzerfaust 100, which had a range of 100 meters, so 40 meters more than the Panzerfaust 60, has nearly the same shape. And they solved it by putting in two black powder loadings. Now, one could say, yeah, two powder loadings, how could this be solving? But they were burned one after another. And this reduces the maximum stress on the barrel, but increased the range. And so the range was really increased by 40 meters. And so the Panzerfaust 100 had the same shape as the Panzerfaust 60. And this is the reason why usually you can't see a difference between the Panzerfaust 60 and the Panzerfaust 100. You see it mostly on the sides where there is 100 as optimum range, and then the 150 as a maximum range where the Panzerfaust 100 could be fired. Also, you see the Panzerfaust material was really an issue. You see it with this here, which looks really cheap, and the reason behind this is really cheap. It is really cheap because they had to save metal and material.
Let us take a look inside. Here we have a cutaway of a Panzerfaust 100. At the front is the hollow charge area of the warhead. Next to it, the shaped high explosive filler. Here is the booster charge, which is attached to the primer. Here you can see the tail of the warhead with the folded tail fins. Note that later variants of the Panzerfaust 100 had delta-shaped fins, not rectangular ones. Now you can imagine how it might have looked when those fins were extended, but I think it is easier to just show you. Finally, here are the two propellant charges of black powder that Jens Wiener mentioned. In comparison, for the Panzerfaust 60, it was only one large charge of propellant, and it was located at the front. The Panzerfaust 60 had a propellant weight of 134 grams, whereas the Panzerfaust 100 had 2 times 95 grams, so 190 grams in total. Now it is time to address some previous errors. Many years ago I did a video on the effectiveness of the Panzerfaust based on some data I had available at the time. Some people pointed out several actual flaws and some imaginary ones as well, So time to address my errors and elaborate on the other points of contention. In my video, I made an error, namely I did not account for the fact that the Panzerfaust was used against other targets than tanks as well. As such, the effectiveness of the Panzerfaust with shots needed per kill was likely lower than shown in the video. As such, it likely had a higher effectiveness. Some people noted that I did make a similar error with the ammunition of the anti-tank guns, but this statement is rather unfounded, since I noted that I mostly used the number of armor-piercing rounds, not high-explosive rounds, as clearly indicated on the screen as you can see here. Of course, back then I did not account for people just listening, not watching, and then commenting. Finally, there were some heated discussions because I translated the Panzerfaust literally with tank fist, while others pointed out it means armored fist. Some claimed the latter was the only correct meaning because on the regulations for the various Panzerfausts there's a huge armored fist showing that it's smashing a T-34, and as such it is clear for them that armored fist is the only correct meaning. The problem is the name Panzerfaust seems to have originated more from the early name Faustpatrone, which indicated firing something out of a fist, so the original fist in the name had nothing to do with armored fist at all. Similarly, another German anti-tank weapon was called Panzerschreck, which literally means tank terror. Yet here we have a complete change in meaning. In early to mid-war, Panzerschreck referred to the troops being in terror or shock from tanks, whereas the weapon's name should mean that the weapon is now a terror or better, a threat to the tank. So as you can see, the meaning of certain names change within several years quite strongly, and sometimes claiming that one translation or interpretation is the only correct one might be a strong oversimplification based on limited amount of data and or life experience. To summarize, the Panzerfaust was the result of the need of a portable anti-tank weapon for the infantry that could be fired above a range that anti-tank hand grenades could be thrown. Initial problems were a warhead that ricocheted off armor and a very limited range. The first issue was solved rather quickly. The successive versions dealt mostly with increasing the range further and further. Especially the Panzerfaust 150 and 250 look very similar to the later Sobat rocket-propelled launchers that are quite common nowadays.
I hope you enjoyed this episode on the evolution of the Panzerfaust. Thank you to Jens Wiener, and also a big thank you to the Military History Museum of the Bundeswehr in Dresden. Thank you to my Patreon and subscriber supporters for making trips like this possible. Thank you for watching and see you next time.